are now listening to the Wolfpack Podcast, featuring your hosts, Corey, Logan, Mike, Nabil, Curto, Marco, and Chris. Sit back, drink your blue milk, and enjoy the show.
Hey, everybody, you're listening to the Wolfpack Podcast, and today we have a very special guest. He's the director of some of the Star Wars The Clone Wars episodes from seasons 1 through 3. He is Giancarlo Volpe. So how are you doing today?
Good. Thanks for having me, everyone.
Oh, yeah, it's an honor. We're going to start with some questions, and we're going to go ahead and start with Mike's question.
Okay, cool. Thanks. So the first question I wanted to ask was, you directed episodes which feature Cad Bane and Savaz Opress, two characters who are known for their ruthlessness. Do you recall any scenes that had to be cut because they were deemed too graphic for the show?
That's a good question. I remember one of the first ones that comes to mind was, this ended up being the first appearance of Cad Bane. And I think it was Hostage Crisis.
Yeah.
And he was with, her name's escaping me now.
Arasing.
Yes, thing. Thank you for that. Arasing, and she executes one of the kind of guards by pointing her yeah. gun at camera. I remember Dave Filoni asked for us to do that, and I was like, are we sure we can get away with this? And, we shot it that way, and it ended up staying. So I was kind of surprised, but I think it also helped that we framed it in a way that we didn't actually show the guy's brain, you know, getting blown out the back of his head. But that was one of those things that was kind of, it's rare for a Cartoon Network show that we could get away with something like that.
Right.
But I think for the most part, we're actually quite conscious of how far we can push things without crossing the line. So I don't recall in those particular episodes a moment where I had to go back and pull back on violence. But I know it did happen on the show.
Okay, cool. Thank you. Mike, go ahead. Your next question.
Oh, thank you. That was a great answer. My next question is, do you know what actor Cad Bane's appearance was based on? Because I always thought it was Clint Eastwood, but I went on Star Wars Wikia and it said Lee Van Cleef.
Yeah, that was the original concept was Lee Van Cleef. But I think what's fun about character creating is that you can start with an inspiration and then you kind of mix in other ingredients. Like, for example, the sort of odd, you know, it's almost Eastern European or something accent that he has, you know, makes him no longer a Western character, but something else. And then, you know, obviously the look of him and everything helps kind of him become his own character. So it doesn't seem like a one for one, copy of someone else. But yeah, the original concept was Lee Van Cleef.
Very cool. Thank you. Mike?
Okay, thank you. My next question is, do you know if, like, Savage refers to Feral, his brother that he killed once, like, you know, it became evil? He refers to Feral as his brother, and then he also refers to Darth Maul as his brother. I was wondering if you could tell me if they're literally, those two guys were his brothers, or is that just, like, a title because they're in, like, the same clan?
Ooh, okay, as far as I understand it, I was under the impression that they were blood brothers, like from the same mother.
Yeah.
Who knows exactly how they procreate on that planet? But that was how I understood it. But it's a good point. Like, I never even thought to interpret it that way, that maybe that's just how they address one another. But it seemed to me that they were related.
Okay. Very cool. Mike, your next question?
Okay, cool, thanks. And then my last question is, when Savage dies, like right next to Darth Maul, he says, brother, I'm an unworthy apprentice. I'm not like you. I never was. And so I'm wondering, do you think that just because Savage was rendered by, like, black magic, essentially, that that makes him, like, less of a warrior than, like, let's say Darth Maul, who took years for training?
Yeah, I think that's what that line was implicating, is that he was more forced to be kind of a, you know, disciple of evil, if you will, whereas I think Darth Maul is kind of innately built for that kind of life. I think that's what he was saying by that, which makes him kind of more of a tragic figure. You know, he's being sort of used by the Night Sisters or you know, whoever you want to kind of point the finger at. Whereas, you know, Darth Maul is just kind of, that's kind of who he is.
Right. For sure.
Really cool. Thank you very much. I actually have to leave now, guys, but thank you very much for all the answers. I really like them. So see you, buddy.
All right. Take care.
Good talking to you.
Good talking to you. Thanks for coming on the show.
All right, Marco, your question?
All right. So I don't know if you pay attention to, like, the more recent news about the Clone Wars, but did you hear anything about the Darth Maul four-part comic book series that's coming out?
I have not.
Oh, okay.
And is that based in the Clone Wars universe?
Yes. They said it was
going to... Does that have anything to do... I did read something recently that they were going to finish the season or finish the series through comics. Is that part of that?
Yeah, that's that.
Yep.
Oh, okay. Well, that's interesting. I mean, I can tell you this. I know that there were, I mean, you guys may already know this, but there,
yeah,
the episodes were in various stages when the kind of plug got pulled on that whole thing. And, you know, some of them were finished or near finished, and some of them were just in script form. So it'd be really interesting to see if they actually go back to those scripts and maybe draw them anyway, but do them as comics instead of, you know, episodes. But I, you know, again, I don't know. I left Clone Wars in like something like 2010 or something.
Oh, okay.
So I, you know, other than a casual catch up conversation with Dave now and then, you know, I'm not as current with that stuff.
Have you seen season 5 at all?
You mean that was the one that aired, right?
Yeah.
I did. I saw bits and pieces of it. I didn't see all of it, but I did see the final episode with Ahsoka leaving the Jedi Order. Okay. And you know, I believe didn't Savage die in season 5?
Yep.
I'm not mistaken.
Yep.
Yeah. So I've seen a number of them for sure.
One of my questions was, when Savage died, when you were making, you know, directing the Savage Night Sister arc, did you know that, did Dave tell you that Savage was going to eventually die, or was that something that wasn't planned yet?
I don't recall him telling me he was going to die. I think the big surprise at the time was, you know, I've got another brother, and we were going to reveal Darth Maul inside of that kind of crystal ball sort of thing. That was the big deal at the time when we were making the episode, like, oh crap, we're going to bring Darth Maul. Yeah. And, you know, especially the fact that, like, the nature of CG animation is that you know you can't really bring anyone onto the show without a lot of planning and a lot of work. So the fact that we had one of our modelers modeling a Darth Maul head, mm-hmm. and, you know, Killian Punkett was, like, designing, you know, Darth Maul in our style was a big deal at the time. We were like, holy crap, this is actually happening. So, you know, I think we were more wowed by that than wondering what Savage's ultimate, you know, fate would be,
mm-hmm.
if that makes sense.
Yeah. Now, out of all the episodes you directed, which one is your absolute favorite episode?
You know, that's a good question. Like, I really like how Hostage Crisis plays. And I did like Lightsaber Lost, I believe, which is, In that, I liked how it sort of was very self-contained.
Right.
One of the things about Clone Wars is that it's a much more serialized episodic show than a lot of cartoons on TV.
Mm-hmm.
And so you know, the Night Sisters trilogy was really cool, but there's also kind of an element of, oh, I did like act one of a movie, and then my buddy Kyle Dunleavy, you know, directed act two, and then I directed act three. So it feels a little bit like a combo effort between the two of us, which is fun in different ways.
Right.
But like, I think that like Lightsaber Lost was kind of a good, like it took Ahsoka on this journey, you know, and really like teaching her to be responsible with her lightsaber and
right
and stuff like that. So it kind of, I'm kind of proud of that one for those reasons, I guess.
Nice. All right, Marco, your next question.
What's the hardest part about directing?
Oh man. You know, that's a good question, because I'm trying to hone in on to exactly like one thing, because there's so many things that's really hard about it. I think that part of it is, as a director, you have to kind of think about the entire story as though you're telling it entirely through your eyes, and you want to control every aspect of it yourself. You want to do every design yourself. You want to point the camera exactly the way you want it. And you can't. I mean, the very neat nature of animation and film as well is that it requires a crew of people. So you have to learn to constantly repeat yourself and tell your crew how you want things to go, and also learn to live with things that aren't quite how you envisioned it, but are close enough. And I think you also have to be open to things playing out differently than you originally envisioned it, that are actually better than your original idea. And you will be a better director if you can recognize that and say, you know what, that's so much better than how I saw it. Look, we'll go with your idea. And the other thing too, on top of all of that, is, you know, also very much trying to execute what Dave was asking for, or what George was asking for. So it's never entirely your vision. You're kind of like a gun for, you know, a hired gun in that regard. Like, so I'm trying to facilitate George and Dave's vision, but also kind of get my fingerprints on it, if you will, so that it still sort of feels like something that I, you know, can be proud of. So it's a lot of that. It's, you know, and on top of all that, just trying to stay on time and, you know, meet your deadlines and everything. But, you know, that's the main thing, is like trying to get your vision on the screen as close as you can see it in your brain, and but also being sort of welcoming the happy surprises.
Right. All right, Marco, your next question.
That kind of made me think of another one just right there. How long does it take to like make like one episode?
That's a very common question I get. I believe that it's somewhere between 9 to 12 months from start to finish.
Wow.
Wow.
So literally it'll, you know, be a germ of an idea, which can be either something Dave came up with, or George, or perhaps one of the writers, and just say, hey, we should do like a trilogy about the Night Sisters, you know. And then, you know, it goes to script, which, you know, can take several months. It goes into a phase of design and modeling, which takes several months. Then we do all the previs and the shooting, which takes several months. And then it gets animated, which takes several months. Everything is kind of like a 2 to 3 month, you know, step, or I guess in some cases one. So when you add all those together, yeah, it's about a year per episode. And the way that we can do, you know, 20 plus episodes a year is that we just stagger the team. So,
mm-hmm. Wow, that's a long time.
Yeah. You know, for example, on Clone Wars, at any given moment, there were 4 to 5 directors. Yeah, that were, you know, working in rotation. So, you know, while one guy is writing the script for episode 8, another guy is actually animating episode 7, and another guy is, you know, pre-vising episode 6. You know, and it kind of works that way. Like you know, it's very carefully orchestrated by the production crew that fills out these intricate schedules and stuff. And I'd like to just sort of say, like, okay, which one am I doing next? Right.
Very cool. So my next question is, as far as, you know, who you worked with, who did you get to work with during the whole show, you know, with all your, you know, episodes, and who was like your most favorite to work with, I guess, or not favorite, but like, what was your favorite episode to work with a group of people, I guess?
Oh man. I mean, like, one of the cool things about this business that I'm in, this kind of applies for everywhere I've worked, but especially on Clone Wars, is you really bond with your team. Mm-hmm. And I miss those guys. You know, we've kind of all been dispersed, especially since Clone Wars wrapped. As I understand it, Rebels has a lot smaller team. So, but, you know, I'm still friends with all of them on Facebook. So, you know, you get to see them grow up and have kids and all that stuff. And you know, occasionally we'll do some crazy, we'll all go to Lake Tahoe or something and, you know, play poker together or something. So, you know, in terms of like, of like who I worked with, like those are, that's the ones that really mean a lot to me. It's just, you know, the guys and the girls of the show.
Right.
But you know, there's also, you know, cool celebrity stuff too that I can throw in there. Like, you know, I got to meet Seth Green, who's always been kind of floating around, you know, Skywalker Ranch, especially with his involvement with, you know, the Star Wars Robot Chicken and stuff like that. And, you know, Kyle Newman and Jamie King, I got to meet them. And you know, Jamie actually voiced
Arsing.
Well, Arsing, as well as the kind of crazy assassin.
Right.
That was in Lightsaber Lost. So, you know, there's all kinds of perks like that that are cool. And obviously George himself, you know, I don't know that it's entirely clear, but every episodic director on Clone Wars got to edit every episode with George. And, you know, so you got to like really just spend several hours with the man and watch him work and collaborate with him. So, you know, it's something that I'm, you know, especially if he's truly retired, you know, it may never happen again. So, you know, I'm really, you know, thankful that I can say I got to do that.
How is it like dealing with the Force from like a witchcraft point of view without like, isn't that like kind of a touchy subject?
Yeah. I mean, again, in Cartoon Network's eyes, yeah, it's a touchy subject. In mine, it isn't. Yeah. I like that take on it because it's kind of like a new twist on the dark side, I guess, or you know, perhaps the origins of the dark side. I don't know. I mean, it's something that I kind of speculated. Mm-hmm. So don't quote me on that as canon or something. But you know, it definitely. I like things like that sort of expand on the universe without breaking the rules, I guess. And right. I felt that was handled well. You know, it's definitely a very dark and creepy kind of trilogy, I guess, that we did there. And so when we had, like, I remember there's that scene where Saj Ventress is being kind of brought back to life, I guess, if you will. It's not that she dies, but mm-hmm. they're kind of resuscitating her.
Yeah.
And you get like little flashes of her origin and stuff. Like, I remember like really pushing the previs artist and some of the stuff I shot myself was like, you know, go like, should be like a satanic ritual or something. like you know, really go for it. You know, not that I'm sort of promoting Satanism or anything, but I think it's appropriate for that kind of thing. Like, it should be creepy, and they, you know, I saw like their eyes rolling in the back of their heads and just kind of mm-hmm. chanting, just being really disturbing. You know, I think that it fits for that culture.
Mm-hmm. Well, I realized the sound like in that episode really made it like put it over the top creepy.
Mm-hmm.
Like when Mother Talzin's voice would kind of get repeated a little bit.
Oh yeah, yeah.
That was so creepy.
I was not in the sound mixes, but you know, it's always you know, a pleasure to see them when they're done. You know, usually Dave would probably be there, but But yeah, I mean, they made some really great choices that enhanced or you know, mirrored what you were seeing on the screen. So I was, you know, happy with that.
Very cool. Now, during the whole entire, like, oh, well, never mind. Did you see those episodes completed? Like, have you watched them?
Oh, yeah. In fact, I think the Night Sisters trilogy, we had like a screening here in Hollywood at the Egyptian. Mm-hmm. And that was really cool because, you know, I believe at the time I had left Clone Wars. And so I had not seen the finished product yet. And so to be able to see it for the first time on a big screen, like a huge audience, was really cool. Like it felt like some kind of a movie premiere or something that I was somehow sort of involved in, but not entirely.
Right.
But yeah, that was a really fun way to like see the finished product.
Very cool. Definitely. Yeah, that Mother Talzin, like we were talking about earlier, that made it really creepy was, you know, her voice. So to see that in the episode was, they did a really good job on that, for sure. And so, all right, my next question is, when did you find out that Darth Maul was coming back? Was it when you came for the Night Sister arc, or was it a previous episode you worked on, or how did you find out, pretty much?
There's a possibility that I heard the, you know, the kind of rumor about it, the little whispering about it that happens on the layout floor.
Right.
The other thing too is that we would do something called design dailies, which involved all of the directors going to the room where the designers are, and we'd kind of visit each desk with Dave, and he'd give feedback to the designers. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we were encouraged to as well chime in if there's anything that we particularly wanted or needed to see in the episode. So as early, and this happens prior to when we start actually shooting them, so it was probably as early as then that you know, Dave was probably telling Killian, like, hey, you ready? You're gonna start drawing Darth Maul next week or something. And, you know, I'm sure all of us were like, what? Wait, what?
Right.
You know, so yeah, I don't know that I remember specifically the moment, you know, because, and not to sound jaded or unappreciative or something, but that happened a lot on that show, you know, mm-hmm. when you'd be like, oh, by the way, we're going to do Boba Fett, you know, or we're going to do whatever, you know, we're going to see Vader for like a brief second, you know, so
mm-hmm.
Anytime those kind of things would happen, like, it almost started to become just part of the job, like,
right.
Well, of course we are. Of course Chewbacca is going to be in this one. Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. Now, for season 5, I think we already talked about this, but just to make sure, have you seen the, you know, that arc with Darth Maul and Savage Opress where they kind of, you know, fight Sidious, and this whole thing is kind of left open where Maul is not dead, but Sidious is torturing him, and he says, you know, I have other plans for you. What exactly do you think, in your opinion, do you think is going to happen with Maul? How do you think, you know, he's going to deal with it? Do you think he's going to get his revenge, or do you think he's just going to end up being killed off?
I wonder about that, because I think a lot of us kind of shared the same sentiment when we watched Phantom Menace, that
mm-hmm.
that we were kind of bummed that Darth Maul died.
Right.
And so, you know, Clone Wars was a great opportunity to bring him back, you know, and I think it would have been equally a bummer if he would have been brought back only to be killed again.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah. This is only my speculation, you know, again, so this isn't like an official quote from what Dave or George were planning, but I think that don't get rid of him, like, he's got to come back in some other form to either get his revenge on Sidious or you know, stir up some more trouble or something. So that would be, from just a narrative standpoint, what I would guess they were thinking with that. It's like, you know, let's not throw away this character for the second time.
Right.
But, you know, it's interesting because when you know also the fate of Palpatine or Sidious, you know, he doesn't, you know, he obviously lives long enough to be killed by Vader instead. So if Darth Maul was trying to put a hit on him or something, he didn't succeed.
Right.
You know. So I don't know. It'd be interesting to see like what exactly happens.
Yeah, definitely.
I'm still bothered by that. I'm such a big Maul fan.
Right.
I just want to know what happened.
Oh yeah, yeah. And you know, it's a great, if nothing else, just teaser to make you want to see another season. And I'm sure when that all that stuff was written, they didn't expect to be canceled. So, mm-hmm. you know, one would think that there's going to be more Darth Maul in the unaired episodes.
Right. So what's your opinion on the whole Disney buyout of Lucasfilm? Do you agree? Do you disagree? Or what do you think about that?
How do I say this? let's put it this way. I think that Disney has done great things with Marvel and the Avengers franchise.
Right.
So it gives me a lot of hope that, you know, that just because Disney bought it, they're not going to Disney-fy it. And you know, I'm choosing my words very carefully here because I actually am a big fan of Disney. I love to go to Disneyland.
Oh, yeah.
But I kind of, you know, it's kind of like a little kid that doesn't want their meat touching their potatoes on their plate or something. You know, I don't really want my Disney stuff to bleed over into my Star Wars and vice versa. But I think that it's in good hands. Mm-hmm. Everything that I've heard, as far as, you know, just little whispers of what's being developed and the plans there, nothing struck me as like, oh God, that sounds like it's going to suck. You know, it seems like they're in, you know, it's in good hands.
Mm-hmm.
The most impactful thing to me is just, you know, I used to think of George Lucas as like one of the last guys who still owned his intellectual property, and
right.
him to finally sell it. It's kind of a bummer because it's like, oh man, he was like the last dude to aspire to be. But I kind of get it though, too. I think that, you know, he, as Dave told me, quoting George, like he's like, look, I got to be either all in with this stuff or all out.
Mm-hmm.
And he couldn't just merely consult on Star Wars. You know, he can't. It's too precious to him. So he's truly riding off into the sunset, if you will. And, you know, he's recently remarried again, and he's got a newborn. And I know family meant a lot to George. So, you know, he's taking a true retiring, you know, kind of stance where it's like, you know, I'm just going to kind of enjoy my life. And, you know, I'm sure that when the episode 7 comes out, he'll be at the premiere. I would be really surprised if he wasn't.
Yeah, definitely. All right, Marco, your next question.
Do you know how Mother Talzin put a charm on Savage in the episodes? I can't think of it correctly, but how do you think Savage broke free from that charm to like fight Dooku and Ventress?
Oh, gosh,
that's one
yeah.
thing I was kind of confused about, but like.
Yeah, gosh, I'm trying to remember exactly what the logic was there, because we talked about that. That was kind of a moment where, you know, we wanted to show him snap out of it. I think it was kind of one of those things where, if I recall correctly, Palpatine was, Dooku was shocking him.
Mm-hmm.
And that sort of sent him off on like a
rampage.
Yeah, a little rampage sort of thing. That, but no, that's actually that happened after the spell was broken, right?
Yeah.
Gosh. Oh man, if I had known, I could go back to the episode and watch that, because I know what you're talking about.
I think it was just like his willpower. Exactly. He just broke it, or.
Yeah, I'm sure there was some sort of tipping point thing that made him kind of, you know, come to cognizance, I guess, if you will.
I think what it kind of was the whole thing where he was fighting Ventress, and or no, fighting Dooku with Ventress, and Ventress was just constantly insulting him, and maybe he just kind of thought, like, why am I kind of, you know, my allegiance is to this person who doesn't respect, you know, what I'm trying to do, and maybe she kind of, or he kind of felt that, like, you know, he was dumb, because I know in the episode you kind of see him, you know, like, blinking his eyes really fast, then he looks up at Dooku and Ventress and just starts choking them, so, I mean, I think that's, he just kind of snapped out because he came to terms, I guess, with what was going on.
Yeah, I mean, it you're right. I think it kind of plays like just the classic, like, you know, his willpower was, you know, he finally overcame it, you know.
Right.
And it was helped by Ventress's, you know, teasing him, and I think she did that on purpose. I think that was sort of the point of that, is that she knew that was like a tactical thing she could do is by kind of taunting him, he'd wake up, and then he would no longer be Dooku's pawn. I think what she was hoping more was that he would be hers instead, but instead it's turned into this three-way battle between the three of them, which, you know, was fun.
Right, but yeah, definitely.
That was kind of the idea. That, at least that's what she was up to.
Definitely, that's awesome.
Thanks for your answer.
Thank you, yeah. Now, Star Wars Rebels is coming out in the fall. Would you be interested in directing any Rebels episodes?
It's such a good, like, it's such a tough thing for me. Dave has been so cool to ask me, like, hey, man, you know, we're making more Star Wars. What do you think? One of the things that was tricky about working on Clone Wars was that it required that I up and leave Los Angeles and move to the Bay Area.
Okay.
And the Bay Area is really awesome, but you know, my wife is especially homesick those 3 years.
Right.
So the whole agreement between the two of us was that, you know, let's do this, you know, for a while, but, you know, we're not going to like live and retire up here.
Right.
So that always hangs over my head. You know, I feel like if Rebels was being done down the street from here, it'd be an easier call to make. Mm-hmm. But because it sort of requires that I, you know, sell my house again or rent out my house again and move back up there, it's just a bigger life decision.
Right.
The other thing too is that I'm super busy. Like if I didn't have a day job already, you know, I could at the very least freelance on Rebels or something like that, just so I could say I did it.
Right. Definitely.
But yeah, it's you know, it's one of those tricky things. But you know, who knows? The other thing, you know, we mentioned Disney earlier. If Disney does yet another series, perhaps under their roof, which is, you know, a 10 to 20 minute drive from my house, mm-hmm. you know, maybe I could return to the Star Wars universe in some other way.
Yeah, I wouldn't doubt that. I mean, they're probably going to have, you know, a few more shows definitely come out after Rebels. So I wouldn't, you know, say no to that. It's probably going to happen. So that'd be pretty cool.
Yeah, I would not be surprised if we actually had more shows coming down the pike in some form or another that are in the Star Wars universe.
Oh, yeah. Marco, your next question?
That's just a simple one. Are you going to Celebration 7?
You know, I've only been to Celebration when it was in L.A. Where is 7 this year?
Anaheim.
It's Anaheim.
Oh, well, that makes it a little easier for me, you know. it could be as simple as, you know, I hope I don't sound like I'm bragging or something, but I could, you know, call Dave and be like, hey, what's the chance of you getting me into that thing?
Oh, yeah, I mean, that'd be cool.
But yeah, you know, that actually wouldn't be a bad idea to go to that. It'd be a good sort of reunion, too, for a lot of us that worked on the show.
Oh, yeah, because even though Clone Wars is over, they still have very focused, you know, panels for Clone Wars. So maybe you can be a part of one of those. That'd be very cool.
Yeah, that's actually really cool too. You actually reminded me when they did Celebration in L.A. This was when Dave was kind of courting me or trying to, you know, seduce me to Clone Wars. Not in a sexual way, but much to my chagrin. No, but we went to kind of like this little after party thing at one of the hotels nearby, and it was comical. It was like a cantina scene because Oh, what's his name? The guy who played R2-D2.
Kenny Baker?
Yeah, Kenny Baker was there at a table with the dude who played Chewbacca. So, I mean, quite literally the shortest person in the room and the tallest person in the room, and they were sharing drinks together. And then, you know, across the room was Jango and Boba Fett. So for some reason, Jango Fett, I forget his name.
Tamar Morrison?
Yes, thank you. Mm-hmm. Was trying to sell watches. It was so weird. you know, it was just like a really cool, like, kind of surreal experience. Like, we laugh about that to this day, that, like, we somehow stumbled upon this, you know, cantina scene in the middle of LA, classic Star Wars, you know, actors. And and it was a good, like, help, like, to make me eventually sign up, because, like, oh, this is too much fun. Like, how could I say no to this?
Right. Now, and you also worked on Avatar The Last Airbender. So during that, did you also get to work with Dave?
Oh, yeah. I mean, we were two doors down from each other. And that was the big joke on that show, was we were always trying to draw parallels to Star Wars on Avatar, or be like, huh, that kind of, or you know, borrowing Star Wars. And
right.
Dave would, he did so so great on, it was the season finale of season one. Mm-hmm. He actually took some music from, I think, Revenge of the Sith, uh-huh, and played it with the animatic just to kind of sell the idea.
Mm-hmm.
We had a reputation as being like the Star Wars nuts on Avatar. So when he got that phone call to actually go up there and interview with George Lucas to make Star Wars, we were all sort of like, what? No. Like, it was almost absurd at the time. I couldn't believe it.
Right.
But yeah, I mean, that we had humble beginnings. I mean, I've actually known Dave as far back as our King of the Hill days, when we were,
wow,
kind of really new to the industry. But you don't have to know Dave very long to find out he was a Star Wars fan even then.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Very cool. Now, for you, when did you get into Star Wars, and how much of a fan are you?
I would say I'm a pretty big fan. I mean, what's interesting is the more that I've met fans like yourself, it makes me think, oh, man, there's guys out there that know a lot more about Star Wars than I do. Like, for example, I'm not a big expanded universe guy. Like, I just haven't read a lot of the comics or the graphic novels and stuff, right, like that. But I get that a lot of people have, and Dave's one of them. You know, he can tell you a lot about those things too. But Star Wars was a huge influence on me just getting into this business. You know, one of my favorite, I mention all three of the original trilogy as one, you know, thing, I guess.
Right.
But one of a huge influence for me getting into this industry. And you know, we were always kind of comparing, again, like I said before, our storytelling or our filmmaking to Star Wars, because we always felt that that was just one of the things that got it so right.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I mean, especially in this case, like, you know, I also worked on Green Lantern, for example, and I've been very public to admit that I wasn't a huge fan of that character until I worked on the show.
Mm-hmm.
With Star Wars, it was one of those things where, like, oh, no, I know this universe very well.
Right.
In fact, I also, you know, Star Wars Galaxies was a big thing at the time.
Yes.
Or, you know, this was like when I was working on King of the Hill, and I remember telling Dave kind of like my war stories from playing that game. And at the time, he couldn't play because he didn't own a PC.
Wow.
It seems so silly now that he didn't just go out and buy one so that he could play with us. But, you know, we were all kind of, you know, working on a budget and everything, so you can't just like buy a computer just because you want to play a video game.
Right.
But like, I would tell him tales of like what we did while playing Star Wars Galaxies, and he would listen so closely because it was like a chance to get like additional lore from Star Wars. It was just such a weird thing. Like, he wanted to hear like updates of us playing this video game because, right, he's starving for like new material. So anyways, that's my long-winded way of answering your question. Like, I hope that that shows though how crazy about this stuff we were.
Oh yeah, that's very cool. That's we didn't know that, so that's very cool to hear. Definitely.
There's also another story I should tell that I don't know that this is too common knowledge, but Dave is was a pretty good cosplayer.
Ooh.
I hope he doesn't get mad at me for divulging this, but for example, he made an awesome Doctor Doom one year.
Mm.
He also made Mecha Godzilla.
Wow.
And so the year that Revenge of the Sith was coming out, and again, this was prior to us all knowing that we were going to work on Skywalker Ranch,
right?
You know, in a year or two. He was really excited, and he was like, who's your favorite kind of, you know, lesser known character? And so I said Kit Fisto, and his was Plo Koon. So we decided, we should go as them during the Revenge of the Sith premiere. And so Dave made this like homemade Kit Fisto and Plo Koon mask. And we ended up paying someone online to make our Jedi robes. But I remember this was a big deal. Kit Fisto has something like 22 tentacles, but we reduced it to 18 just to make it a little more manageable.
Right.
But we were pouring molds to make these Kit Fisto tentacles in between playing Star Wars Risk. You know, just unapologetically nerding out, you know, having right. no idea that we were going to go work on Star Wars or meet or know George Lucas. And I remember that was like the big joke at the time was like, look, when you go for the interview, whatever you do, don't mention that you're working on a Plo Koon mask or he's going to like ban you. But I mean, in retrospect, I don't think George would have done that. But, right. but you know, that was what we speculated at the time.
That's awesome.
there's photos of that, actually. If you Google like Kit Fisto and Plo Koon, you'll see pictures of us together. That's me and him.
I'm Googling it right now. Awesome. So for Rebels, what's kind of your speculation on what you think and hoping is going to happen? You know, do you hope to see Ahsoka and Darth Maul come back, or what are you hoping for?
Oh, yeah. First of all, one of the original ideas for Clone Wars, and if you've seen the Art of Clone Wars book, there's a sketch of this. One of Dave's ideas was he wanted to just have like more of a ragtag group of previously unestablished characters. And things like Obi-Wan would be like Obi-Wan making an appearance would be a rare thing. So the concept was you'd be watching Clone Wars and say, holy crap, did you watch Clone Wars last night? Obi-Wan made an appearance. Like that would be a big deal.
Right.
But For better or for worse, George Lucas was thinking, no, let's stick with the main characters that are in the movies. Like, that's the characters that the audience wants to see. So they made it more about Anakin and Obi-Wan. And then the big curveball was Ahsoka's, creation or her involvement.
Mm-hmm.
So there's still a part of me that kind of would love to see how that series would have played out, Dave's original idea. So I'd be really curious to see if Rebels is a little bit more in that spirit. I think it also kind of matches thematically. Like if you're talking about the rebellion, it would be more of a ragtag, nondescript group of characters as opposed to, you know, the major players. But that having been said, I'm really curious to see if this continues the continuity of Clone Wars. And that could be, I would speculate that if it was up to Dave, he would say absolutely. Disney might not want that. And again, not to paint them as bad guys, but it's like, are you going to make continuity for a show that appeared on another network? You know, there could be legal sticky things that could stop that from happening. But man, if we're watching that show and like an adult Ahsoka shows up or something, that would be really cool. Or even if they got, James Arnold Taylor to reprise his role as Obi-Wan, even if it's kind of, actually, Rebels takes place before New Hope, right?
Right.
So yeah, you know, that'd be amazing if he could still play Obi-Wan. Like,
that'd be sweet.
I don't know. You know, I don't know. And you have to know that, like, probably could ask Dave some really good questions like that. And he's notoriously tight-lipped. Like, he kind of likes withholding information from his friends. Like, he likes what that does to us. But I think in a weird way, I almost don't want to know until I watch it. You know, right. Like, because then I'll enjoy it as it's meant to be presented.
Definitely, definitely. Now, I'm not sure if you know this or not, but Dave actually, based on our podcast name, the Wolfpack Podcast, actually, Dave created the Wolfpack Clone Troopers. So,
oh, yeah.
That's kind of cool that you mentioned, you know, how much of a fan Dave is, because we based our name after his Wolfpack, so that's
just that. I was wondering at that. I mean, it had to have been the same thing.
Yeah, yeah. So, also, my next question is, what advice do you have for people like myself that is trying to get into directing? You know, what do you think, what advice would you give them?
That's a good question. When you say directing, do you mean live action or animated?
Animated, yeah.
Okay, so with animation, then the route that I took to become a director, and this is very similar with Dave Filoni as well, is that, you know, you get in at like a ground level job at an animation studio, and then work your way up the ranks. And, you know, we both studied animation in college. The major key is to have a really impressive portfolio that shows off your best artwork. That will get you into a good college. That will get you into a good job.
Right.
And nowadays, everyone puts their portfolio online. So it's really more like a website. Like, have your best work on a website. And then, you know, we always kind of studied up, if that makes sense. So, like, if we were doing, like, character layout on King of the Hill, we worked very closely with the storyboards. And so by looking at these boards, we kind of learned how to draw storyboards. And, you know, you kind of just keep studying whoever's one notch above you, you know,
right,
in the hierarchy, to just to kind of see, well, how are they doing it? And, you know, if you keep excelling at what you do, you'll get your employer's attention. They'll be like, man, this guy can really handle no matter what's thrown at him. Maybe he could be an assistant director, or maybe he can be a director. That was the route that we took. Now, that having been said, I feel like a lot has changed in technology from even when we entered the business, where now it's so easy to make your own films with, you know, you can even just do it with an iPhone now, and like iMovie, right, or something like that. So there's a whole other angle there where just make movies, you know, especially if you can get your hands on some affordable animation software, just make stuff and throw it on YouTube, because you will get better the more you just make movies. And so, you know, that's something that I didn't do as much of coming up, but it seems like, you know, another avenue that can't be discredited.
Right. Now, for animation, would you say that making little animated movies here and there, you know, like you said, to put up on YouTube will help you kind of in your career for directing? You know, once you get there, you can present them and, you know, it'll help you?
Yeah, I mean, you know, the dream thing is that you throw a short or a series of shorts on YouTube that get millions of hits. Believe me, if that happens, then the studios will call you and say, hey, do you want to develop this into a TV series? That has happened before.
Right.
But even if it doesn't get that big, let's just say for the sake of argument, you just work on a run cycle for a horse and you get it in really good shape. And you're like, you know, this looks really cool. I'm going to throw it on YouTube. You never know when you're on the job and someone might say, hey, we need this horse animated for you know, X, Y, Z reasons.
Right.
You know, you can suddenly be the specialist because you've tackled it once before. And I think there's something to be said for that. Like, just every time if you asked me to draw Ahsoka, I'd probably do a much better job of it than if you asked me to draw some character that, you know, say Fred Flintstone or something, where I've never actually worked on that show. You know, I can I know her proportions better. I know the markings on her face. I'd have to kind of think really hard to draw Fred Flintstone or, you know, some character that I haven't done numerous times before. So that's my long way of saying, if you draw something over and over again, you're going to get a lot better at it. And mm-hmm. I think the same goes for sort of animating and filmmaking. Like, just if you've done, I've done so many action scenes from my work on Avatar and Clone Wars and Green Lantern, that now if someone says, hey, we're going to do a crazy spaceship battle, it's not like, oh my God, how do you do that? It's more like, oh yeah, that again. You know, like, right. I've been down the road. You know, I hope I don't sound like I'm bragging or something.
No.
But that's kind of how you build experience and confidence,
right,
in this kind of thing.
Well, thank you. That's a very, very good answer for that. Marco, next question?
It's kind of like a two-part question, but do you get to work with the voice actors directly?
You're directing? Yes and no. I mean, typically on Clone Wars, we weren't invited to the record sessions because they actually did them in L.A. The reason for that is that it's less expensive to send Dave down to L.A. to record the voice actors than to send, say, 12 voice actors up to the Bay Area.
Mm-hmm.
So because of that, we weren't in a lot of the records, but I got to go to one or two of them just as sort of like a learning experience / thank you for all of the episodic directors. So I got to go to a few.
Okay,
sweet.
All right, Marco, your other question?
Was Clancy Brown, like, do you know if he was the first acting choice or voice acting choice for Savage?
Ooh, you know, I don't know exactly. Like, okay. That can happen in this business where you just call, you just like, no, like, this is the guy for the job. Go get him. But I do know that on Clone Wars, there were just open calls like any other gig where you just have a series of voice actors submit their work and or, you know, they audition for it, you know. We actually use Clancy Brown on Green Lantern, and he's got just kind of a naturally deep voice. So I would imagine that if there was an auditioning process, his just sounded, you know, most appropriate for that role, especially how tall Savage Opress was, and, you know, and kind of baritone and barrel chested he is. It's a good fit for Clancy Brown.
Right. All right. Final questions. Marco, your final question?
I think I've pretty much got all mine. I just want to thank you for coming on.
Oh, yeah. Thank you for having me.
Oh, yeah. Same here. My last question is with Sam Witwer. I know you said you sometimes got to work with, you know, the voice actors, but for any of the particular Savage episodes, were you able to go down there or no?
I did not get to go down there, but I did, you know, again, at that screening that we had at the Egyptian, a lot of them were there.
Right.
But I did not meet Sam. That was just one of those unfortunate, you know, we weren't in the same place at the same time kind of things.
Right. I'm sure you guys will be able to meet at, you know, if you go to that celebration, it'll probably, you know, that'll be cool.
Yeah. The cool thing about that too is that I saw even at my local, you know, kind of coffee shop, and, you know, I've met him a few times, but we're not close friends. But just the fact that I was like, "Hey, are you Matt Lanter? I directed on before." It's like this bonding thing. Like, he instantly, like, "Oh, cool!" You know, we you know, did a little brief talk and catch up there.
Right.
So that's always fun. Like, and you know, it's the nature of the business is that those guys, the actors, kind of go into a recording booth, and we're in the animation studio, so we never really cross paths with each other, unless you're like a showrunner like Dave is. Like, for example, on Green Lantern, then I got to meet the actors all the time. But but yeah, there's that camaraderie and that sort of sense of like we're all part of the same family. That's really cool. That even kind of spills over in the feature world as well. Like, you know, I've got to meet Ben Burtt because of, you know, just working up there and you know, Matt Wood, who did a lot of the sound design on the prequels as well as, you know, our show. So that's always fun to, like, kind of be a part of that greater Star Wars family.
Right. Definitely. And my final question is, I know Dave, I've seen some pictures where Dave has like a ton of Star Wars action figures. So are you a collector of anything? Do you collect any action figures? Or?
You know, it's weird. I'm not fishing for sympathy here, but I grew up not with a lot of money. So when the original Star Wars came out, I didn't own a lot of them. I think I like maybe had an R2-D2 and a C-3PO. And I loved it. You know, I would have loved to have more, but we just, you know, I didn't have a lot of them. And then there was a period when, you know, we started to get into the animation industry and we were making good money. And, you know, it's so easy to just go to Toys R Us and get those, like, reissues and stuff like that. Right. So, yeah, there was a point where, like, I was getting a lot of stuff. But I think that my collection pales in comparison to Dave's. Like, his is just, I mean, it got to the point where, you know, going back to, like, that Plote Koon and Kit Fisto thing that we did, we actually brought a sack full of action figures from Star Wars
that
we just didn't have any room for, and we were giving it away to kids in line.
Wow, that's awesome.
It was just one of those kind of cool things that, like, well, you know, we could eBay this stuff or we could just kind of give it away in the spirit of just how excited we were. So I kind of feel like maybe I've moved past collecting stuff, but you know, there's certain things that I won't get rid of. Like, I have a really cool Kit Fisto maquette that's in the style of Clone Wars that, you know, I'll probably never get rid of.
Right. Well, thank you very much for coming on. I mean, it's been a pleasure to be able to chat with you about, you know, everything. Now, do you want to really quickly promote anything that's coming up for you?
Oh, yeah. A couple things. I don't know if you guys are aware of this, but I also do a podcast called The Big Pull Podcast.
Okay.
And so if, you know, any of your listeners would like to tune in, it'd be appreciated. We tend to cover kind of pop culture, so including like movies and TV shows.
Okay.
Specifically or especially having to do with comics, but we love to talk Star Wars and you know, even Star Trek on that show. So if you ever kind of just want, you know, something like that, please tune in.
Sure, very, very cool.
And I know this is a little cheesy, but I always like to tell people to follow me on Tumblr and Twitter. So my Tumblr account is Giancarlo Volpe with no space .tumblr.com. And my Twitter let me double check this. Oh yeah, it's @Giancarlo_Volpe.
Okay.
Probably the hardest thing is just spelling my name correctly.
We'll put those all
down. You know, you can find me.
Uh-huh. We'll put those all in the description so that people can check it out and tune into your podcast. That's very cool.
Oh yeah, that would be appreciated. And the last thing I'll say, I'll give you guys a little heads up, is that I did a project most recently for Warner Brothers that is coming out very soon. I can't quite announce the premiere date, but it's coming really soon, so please keep an eye out for that. I'm sure that when I can mention it, I will tweet about it. So
okay, very cool. We'll be on the lookout for that.
Awesome.
All right, well, thanks for tuning in, coming on the show. Hopefully we can get you on another time and we can talk some more of your what you're up to.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me. It's always good to kind of go back and reminisce about the good old days.
Well, if we ever manage to get Dave on the show, we can, I guess, do a little two-part thing and you can come on as well. That'd be pretty cool.
Oh, that'd be awesome. Yeah, maybe the both of us.
Yeah, definitely. All right, well, take care. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
You too. Have a good one.
All right, you too.
See you guys.
Bye.
All rights belong to Disney and Lucasfilm or their respective copyright holders. This is a fan podcast only meant for entertainment and information purposes. Head on over to StarWars.com for any official news, and be sure to subscribe to our channel, and the Force will be with you always.